Thank you.
Hey, good morning, everybody. If we have to evacuate the building, there's two stairwells, one down on, down in the hall on the right, and the one just past Janice's desk on the left, okay? It's gonna put you out front of the building. Our muster point for the sixth floor is right there at Granby. Just kinda right around where the old Moffett Station area used to be, kinda so you're underneath that overhang. And Kate, I'll ask you to just get a head count so we do make sure everybody's there. In this hallway down on the right, there's the AED and a portable fire extinguisher. Janet has a first aid kit back at her desk, so I'm in my office, so if there's any medical fire, just come get me, alright? And if any ready, if you're in doubt, dial 911 and report the message, alright? The only other thing I'd like to mention, our blue light system that's in the overhead, that has no audible, all it does is flash. And if that's flashing, that means we have an active threat going on the sixth floor. So before we go running out of the room, get situation awareness, it may be safer to shelter in place or you head for the stairwells, okay? So, any questions? Alright.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, thank you.
No worries, have a good meeting.
Thank you.
And Ms. Nashbush, you've got some COVID-19 safety procedures?
Yes, I just wanna remind everybody, we're wearing our masks, we are keeping at least 6 feet physical distance from each other. You will be provided with boxed lunches to take on your way out at the conclusion of this meeting. Because we are speaking in masks so that everybody can hear us and we can be recorded properly, will you please use the microphone when speaking to the group? And as far as this being a hybrid meeting, some virtual announcements, the law allows for fully virtual meetings during the pandemic, but it places special obligations to ensure we continue to promote meaningful public access and participation. The meeting is being recorded and the recording will be posted on our website. We ask you keep your video on, but there is no requirement. If it is a requirement for all board members to be able to hear each other's voices, please mute when you are not speaking. Our board members are all present today, but we have council participating virtually. The meeting must be suspended for any broadcast interruptions until public access can be restored. All votes must be recorded in roll call fashion. We will do so alphabetically by last name, so please be ready when your name is called. Thank you very much.
Okay, thank you. Can I get an approval of the agenda? Let's take a vote.
Roll call vote, Captain Chisman?
Aye.
Mr. Coleman?
Aye.
Ms. Pearsall?
Aye.
Unanimously passes.
So the next item is the process for reviewing potential disciplinary complaints. Mr. Coleman, I believe you had asked about going into closed session. And prior to doing so, can you, because we might, I mean, I don't know, what does it mean by going into closed session and what would be different than just having a meeting?
The Freedom of Information Act provides for limited reasons why the board can go into a closed meeting. And one of them is to receive legal advice for specific legal matters. This agenda item is one. And so if the board votes to go into a closed meeting, there's a specific motion that must be made. And Kate has the language to do so. And then the meeting is closed just to board members and any non-members who are necessary or helpful for purposes of that limited discussion. That closed meeting has to be limited to that legal advice and that specific legal matter. And then when the board comes out of that closed meeting, each member votes on the certification that the conversation was limited to those matters. And of course, the purpose is to ensure that any meeting at which the public is not included is limited to those specific, one of those specific allowable exclusions.
Correct. And does that also mean that when we go into a full board meeting to discuss this, we also have to go to closed session?
Anything that would be discussed in a closed meeting in order to remain part of that closed meeting cannot otherwise be discussed. And of course, in order to exercise the exemption for a specific legal matter and legal advice, in order to remain out of the public record, anything that would be attorney-client privilege needs not to be discussed with or shared with anyone outside of that attorney-client relationship.
So if I understand you, then if we're in an executive session to discuss this when it's on the regular board agenda, that section of the agenda would be an executive session as well?
Yes.
But the rest of the board could hear what we discussed or be apprised of what we discussed in a closed session.
In a closed session, properly motioned.
But there would be no others able to be a part of the meeting if we go into closed session.
Or the communications surrounding it.
Well, if I may ask, Paul Kirchner, could he be included because he's senior counsel with the American Pilot Association?
No.
If the committee so chooses as to give perspective on this?
I think it would waive our privilege, wouldn't it?
Correct.
Okay. If I could just add, because I know we have not done this with current board members, we haven't gone into a closed session. We will stop recording at that time, and we do not take minutes of what goes on in closed session as well.
Okay. I think that the purpose of our meeting today in this committee is to go through the procedures related to receiving and reviewing a complaint and make sure that we're not doing anything in our procedure that would be a violation of the APA. So in my mind, all of that hinges on being provided legal counsel. I would think that would, you know, require a closed session.
Is there any discussion? All right, would you want to make the motion?
Madam President, I move that this meeting be recessed and that the board for branch pilots, this committee immediately reconvene in closed meeting for the purpose of consultation with legal counsel employed or retained by our public body regarding specific legal matters requiring the provision of legal advice by such counsel as permitted by section 2.23711A8 of the Code of Virginia.
And the specific agenda item?
To review the legal opinion provided by the Attorney General's office regarding tainting in response to my letter, and to review different scenarios related to receipt of complaints and receive legal opinion on those scenarios. Item number four, yes, thank you.
Do I need a second?
We're going to do a roll call vote.
Second. I second the motion.
All right. And then Captain Chisman.
Aye.
Mr. Coleman.
Aye.
Ms. Parasol.
Aye.
Motion carries. So we're going into closed session.
Would you like any non-members council?
Well, that's what I asked if Paul Kirchner could attend, but
it would be limited to staff or council.
Mr. Coleman, the names on that.
So that would be Kate and Bonnie.
I'm sorry.
Yeah, I would then allow me to amend the motion to.
The law is rather specific as to it needs to be staff or count non-members necessary to assist with the discussion.
You're saying we need a motion for the three of you to be in here?
The motion needs to name the non-members to be included.
Then I would amend my motion to include in the meeting Mary Burris Vaughn, Elizabeth B. Council, and Kate Nobish and Bonnie Davis in the closed session.
And I second the amendment.
Roll call, Captain Chisman.
Aye.
Mr. Coleman.
Aye.
Ms. Parasol.
Aye.
All right, so we're going into closed session now. And so we will let you know when we come out of closed session. Mark and Paul, and we're taking Elizabeth into a breakout room for closed session.
Thank you, Elizabeth, for your help.
Thank you.
Happy to help.
Whereas the Board for Branch Pilots has convened a closed meeting on March 2, 2021, pursuant to an affirmative recorded vote in accordance with the provisions of the Virginia Freedom of Information Act, and whereas 2.2-3712 of the Code of Virginia requires a certification by this Board for Branch Pilots that such closed meeting was conducted in conformity with Virginia law, now, therefore, be it resolved that the Board for Branch Pilots hereby certifies that to the best of each member's knowledge, I, only public business matters lawfully exempted from open meeting requirements by Virginia law, which were discussed in the closed meeting to which the certification resolution applies, and II, only such public matters such as were identified in the motion convening the closed meeting were heard, discussed, or considered by the Board for Branch Pilots. I'll do roll call vote. Captain Chisman?
Aye.
Mr. Coleman?
Aye.
Ms. Parasol?
Aye.
Thank you. The ayes, three ayes, no nays, and we are in open session. And
Madam President, can we recess for 10 minutes?
Absolutely. We will reconvene at 12:36.
they don't have anything on it for this room.
Things behind your ears, like.
Good, how are you? I think this room is still limited to 10 different people for a board meeting next week, so we're going to have to, I was going to mention that when we reconvene. Don't have a couple minutes according to my.
My daughter told me that the suit is too light of the color to be wearing in her time.
How old is she?
She's 14.
I was just joking because it's almost pretty similar.
What did she say?
He's wearing a summer suit.
Oh.
Daughter.
She called me out this morning when I was leaving the house. I really appreciate it.
How does she know?
No, I did. She knows things.
I guess I have to wait for everybody if we are still. All right, we're going to go back into session. thank you. Do we have anything further? I think the plan is that at our board meeting, the committee will make a recommendation to the board in closed session that we will vote on based on our recommendations. Is there any other further discussions?
The only thing, Madam President, that I'd like to discuss briefly, I think, you know, we've got the APA construct and understanding, I think, now to go back to the board of the recommendation, the legal side of things. I also want to talk about the functional side of how we respond in the event of a major incident. I had mentioned before that should there be a major incident, say the worst case scenario, that there's a collision and the ship channel's blocked and the port is shut down, that all eyes would be on this port. It's possible we inevitably have been involved. And I think our reliance on DPOR to conduct investigations is certainly a good one, but we're relying on DPOR to investigate, and how they investigate will reflect on the board ultimately. We explored previously as board in response to the situation. Having maritime investigators on retainer, and I guess with DPOR, we're just available to DPOR, so the DPOR will use them when conducting an investigation or fact finding on behalf of the board to present information to the board. So I would like to talk about that. Again, this is just kind of the practical side of how things are going to proceed if there is an incident in the middle of the night that's catastrophic. So with that, I guess I would ask Director Rezvan to maybe give us some guidance. I know we've talked about it before. You have an individual currently on the board who has maritime investigation experience, which is great. I don't know that that'll always be the case. But I think it's important that we do have some other folks available for people to call upon should there be a major issue or incident.
Absolutely. We are fortunate at DPOR. We actually have two Coast Guard veterans. But again, don't know that that will always be the case. We are able to enter into procurement agreements with consultants and to have anyone on retainer. And so we would be happy to and would need to rely on the board to make recommendations to us for, you know, folks to be able to do that.
Would it be possible for DPOR to make a solicitation to get get resumes?
We certainly can do that. A request for, you know, professional services in that regard. We first would need assistance in, you know, what sort of qualifications we should include in that. And then we would have them sort of on call for that purpose.
Right. And Madam President, as you recall, I believe it was at the June 2020 meeting that I was charged with identifying potential investigators, and the one that I did present a resume to the board, he's taking employment elsewhere, so he is now off, out of consideration. And I've had discussions with Paul Kirchner, and they're really, unfortunately, there are not very many of them around, so I think that like a broad solicitation would be the best way to procure that.
Now, I would recommend that you have at least two available, just in case there's any potential conflict where they're representing the PNI club or a vessel owner or something like that. You have a backup. And the point of this is only that, I think in terms of public perception, that knowing that DPOR, they also have people with a Coast Guard background investigating, but also a professional was hired to come in and investigate on behalf of the board with DPOR. Mm-hmm. Beneficial in making determinations down the road.
And certainly in the event of something catastrophic of that nature, we would be coordinating not only with the board, but with the port, with the governor's office, with the delegation. to ensure an appropriately coordinated response, because something like that would impact so much of.
We can certainly discuss this further with the full board next week, but I just want to remind you that we exist solely on licensees' fees, so this could have an impact on the fee that the regulants pay to be able to have people on retainer. So just to put that in the back of your mind as we proceed forward.
Does an individual that you would call upon have to be kept on retainer? Or could you just have a list of potential investigators who are qualified in the maritime space?
I suppose that would depend on the individual and their willingness.
Right.
And what I've discussed is that it's best to have them on retainer. Otherwise, they would probably have been major accident. They could get scooped up and be representing someone else.
That was it for me.
Okay. Anything else?
I would just like to also let you know that I believe we're still on restriction in this room to 10, and the board is 9 by itself. So I know at the December meeting, I was here with you all, and Ms. Brezvon and Ms. P participated virtually. So unless that restriction changes, I just wanted to make you aware that we are limited to 10 right now.
The governor's orders didn't change that for inside meetings?
Not that I'm aware of, and this building is also following the governor's guidelines saying no more than 10 in this room. So.
What happens if members of the public show up?
That's why we have to do a hybrid and virtual, so that like Mr. Coberly and Mr. Kirshner could, it's noticed that way, that it's a hybrid meeting. So the public, we have to have a meeting where the public has access. And that's why we've been holding these meetings in a hybrid format, so that the public does have access. It's noticed that way on town hall. They can't come in here, but they can participate virtually. But just because of all the nuances and knowing that we'll probably go into closed session next week, I think I'll be bringing Ms. Davis with me, maybe setting her up in a smaller boardroom. Oh.
And is there not an alternative meeting location that could accommodate more than 10 people?
That's the governor's order. It doesn't matter where it is.
Well, yeah. And so we do have one boardroom at our agency. I do not know if it's available next Friday or not. Historically, the meetings have always been here. I don't know of any other locations in this area.
We'll also check, because I know, I mean, the order did change as of yesterday.
I know, but I think outdoor you had more.
It was outdoor.
I think indoor didn't change.
It didn't.
So.
Maybe if the weather's nice, we could have.
There we go.
There's that nice park on the other side of it.
Take the screens with us. Take some laptops with us. I thank everybody for their hard work on this committee and your responses and the research you put behind it. I think we're ready to present with Mike making the report, and obviously Whiting and I contributing to your report at our meeting next week. And everybody stay safe. I'm going to adjourn this committee meeting. Please sign your conflict of interest forms and travel vouchers. Is it adjourned? Thank you, guys.
Thank you.
Thank you for your patience, Mary.